Good afternoon, everyone. It's my honor to welcome you all in the second edition of Orange City Literature Fest, organized by NCR Knowledge Foundation. I, Apoorva Ahuja, will be the anchor for this session, and the topic of this session is Art of Reading Self Through Your Stories for 16 plus age group. The guest of this session is Gitanjali Paul. She is a pedagogy expert, circle, facilitator, performative storyteller, creative and mindfulness coach and educator for 2 decades. Award winner and speaker for Exceptional Women of Excellence at WES. She believes the way you tell your story matters. Stories have the power to cure. Her process work guides participants to embark on a journey that leads to inner transformation. She has completed a leadership program from RCI Berlin in collaboration with TISS, nurturing over 500 souls in heart and craft of storytelling, creating safe space to tell their personal narrative over 20 plus theme-centered meet-ups and directed plays. Her intense work has built an organization of storytellers. Also, storytelling in collaboration with United Way Mumbai Let's Read program has reached over 200 schools. Her work includes holding restorative circle, mindfulness workshops, and organizational storytelling, one-on-one coaching on transformational journey. Handing the session to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Apoorva. That was a beautiful introduction. So yes, my topic is Art of Leading Self Through Stories. So there are three words here. One is leading, that is leading. Okay. Second is self, that is inner work, self-work. And third is stories. So if you talk about leading, self, and stories, to a storyteller, it all comes together in a self-worth pot, inside which you're mixing your ingredients of your lived experiences, of times when you have inspired self in others, of different influences of your life, and then the potpourri is ready to serve others through a well-crafted story that inspires. Now, why stories? First of all, stories bring the space which is no judging, no blaming, no explaining, no complaining, only stories that can inspire self, connect eyeball to eyeball, heart to heart, and mind to mind, and creates a sacred, safe space for telling as well as listening. And that's why we believe in the power of stories. So stories bring in all the dimension to do with leadership. All successful leaders often do storytelling. It has been told that the former CEO of GE, Jack Welch, he was a C+ student and a really second-rate student. He was once asked the most important attribute that he had. He said, "What really counts is that I'm Irish and I know how to tell stories." There's a lot of truth to that. So that's what the best CEOs, even when you go for interviews these days, people don't ask, your degrees, your certificates, your mark sheets, but they ask you to tell a good story of your life. So today, storytelling has become a way to communicate. And that's why we are embarking on the power of telling stories. Now, what is we bring authentic stories, because today we're talking about personal stories, your life stories. So whenever otherwise the stories are being told, the stories are being told from a copy. You tell stories of Mahatma Gandhi or maybe Nehru of here and there. But when you're telling stories of yourself, of your life stories, It is a story which is completely unique, which is different than someone else's. It is different. It is not the same, right? So it's your viewpoint and it's your story. So it becomes authentic. And we are also not talking about written stories. We're talking about spoken stories. We're talking about oral storytelling. So oral storytelling brings voice, an authentic lived experience voice. So that's where we are today talking about. So we're talking about being authentic through your stories. We're talking about spoken stories, and we're talking about building successful life stories through the stories that you tell. Now, what are these stories? I mean, I think from the time I know myself, my brain is filled with the stories, right? I mean, today, if I close my eyes, something or the other starts appearing. There is a story, you know, spinning inside all the time, right? So, you know, great author Patrick Rothfuss has said, it's like everyone tells a story about themselves inside their own head, always, all the time. And that story makes you. So what you are, what you have done in your life, we build ourselves out of all the stories that our brain has been capturing, thinking, connecting, and feeling. So why is story so powerful? So why stories are so powerful? Because our mind, our brain is only thinking in images, only in pictures, right? Apurva, like you're all the time thinking in pictures, you're thinking in images. So these images bring feelings and they also bring sensations. They talk about your perceptions about the world. And the more and more the images are getting formed, you also connect and associate to the other brain. So the images are coming from the right brain. When the image starts coming, your brain starts living in the present moment. And the moment the image starts coming in, the left brain connects to the right brain and gives it, you know, food, feeds it the food for building a good image. Who, when, and where. Like, for instance, if I tell you in the 2nd century when the Chinese dynasty was formed, Princess Li Zhu sat in the imperial garden outside the imperial palace on a bench and sat her and drank her Chinese tea. You quickly get an image, right? So this image brought a lot of information, data, and a picture that connected to you, and soon the story started weaving in your brain. So the right brain and the left brain came together through images and associations. So our brain is hardwired to remember through stories. And that's why storytelling works. Now the power is, how do you tell your stories effectively? I mean, everyone is telling a story, but everybody is not telling a good story. So how to tell a story so that it becomes very effective? To make your story very effective, first of all, you need to have a very good structure. A lot of times I've seen, I've been working with, you know, young adults, teenagers, and even working people, working men and women. I see the generation also wants to run towards solving the problem before even knowing the problem. So discussing the problem in detailing creates a stimulation for the listener to, you know, open their hearts to know what is going to happen next. So it's extremely important to focus on the dark sides of the story. What actually is your problem? So you have to dig deep, dive to the story, bring out the triggers that are building in the story. And then you talk about the turning point, which builds and builds and brings a transformation in the story. So the three structures, main structures in the story is trigger, transformation, and what is that lesson that you picked up in your story? Okay, these are the three important structures in the story. The second most important thing is to first of all work on your story. First comes the story, second comes the listener, who is your audience, and third comes the teller. The teller brings the bridge between the story and the listener. So these are the most important things that you need to think about when you're talking about how stories. And then once you work on your story, once you bring your context, the story content, context, everything is ready. You need to now start cooking up the story. So you have to bring visual details in the stories. You haven't told a story unless you haven't brought in dialogues. Bring in dialogue in the story. Work towards the ending of the story. So as I mentioned, the dark side of the story is very important. See, you will not know what is light until you don't see the darkness. So you really need to bring the dark parts of your life. Oh no, if I tell this to everybody that once, you know, I was bankrupt, or, you know, my family was very poor. We just had two pairs of clothes to wear. Everybody will judge me. Sorry, then you're not telling a story. So you have to say how dark you felt your life was. After that, you crack open to bring the light through the story. So once you bring the dark side of the story and then you bring the light of the story, after that, you have to work towards the ending of the story. The ending of the story is, what did I learn from my story? What did I pick up from my story? And it is happily ever after. That's why this episode and the story comes to a particular knot, ending. So closures are very important to any story that you open up. It could be of a relationship. It could be a relationship about how I handled my father's death. Yeah. It could be a relationship about a best friendship that broke up. Yeah. It could be about me looking for that particular job which I didn't get, but then I landed somewhere else and I was destined to be there. It could be about all the choices that I have made and the decisions that I took that changed me, changed the Gitanjali inside me. It's the story that I'm telling her. So endings play a very important role. So it's important that you give at least a good pause before you come towards the end of your story. Okay, because the end of the story is, what is that your listener is dreaming after he or she listens to your story? Yeah? So the listener feels, wow, this is the treasure I've taken after having conversation with this one. So it's extremely important to, you know, give that space, a sacred space, once the story is floating and floating and floating. At the same time, as I mentioned, story needs to have a riverside and a river flowing. Needs to have a good structure and good connections, turning point, going deep down and coming up. So until Cinderella did not have that moment in her life where the stepsisters went for the ball party and she didn't go, there was no deep bottom part of the story. There was no jaw-dropping moment. There were problems, right? So we kept talking about her problems, that her mother passed away. The stepmother was very cruel. The stepsisters were very cruel. She did a lot of work in the house. She picked up lentils in between the ashes and she went to sleep in the ashes, and soon they called her Cinderella. So how torturous was her life? We kept talking about it. The more and the more and the more we speak about her, about the protagonists, or sorrow land, or that part of a story which was filled with grief, the more the listeners connect to your story. That's where image to image, eye to eye, heart to heart happens. Yeah, so this is, you know, parts of working with a good story, which is what a storyteller would give to anyone who comes for a workshop. Now today we are also talking about leadership stories. What are leadership stories? Leadership stories are stories about how did I deal with my own fears? How did I overcome my fears? How did I overcome my obstacles? How did I work with my mistakes? If I'm only going to tell you everything is so good about my life, you know, I can deal with anything. I am super good. I am super mom. I'm a super woman. Nobody is going to listen to my story. The moment Gitanjali will open her mouth, after some few seconds, everybody is out from this camp. Yeah, you feel intimidated with a superwoman story, right? Gitanjali has to make mistakes. That's how she will connect to her audience. Gitanjali has to have the pain. Like, I was growing tall. I'm 5.9 and a half feet tall. And I have been bullied. I have been told, lambu, lambu. Lambu is a word that I grew up with. And how I actually started embracing my body. How I soon figured that I have a voice which is so powerful. I have a body which is so powerful. I've got arms that can build up a story. And I built a storyteller in me. So until I don't tell things, you know, which were my dark sides, you will not enjoy my bright sides. So polarities are extremely important in a good story. And second part of a good story is that you need to connect the story. So if I'm going to always complain in my story that, because of this, this happened, because of that, this happened, because of the pandemic, I lost my job. Because this happened. So I'm always, because of that one, this happened, because of this one, I'm always blaming people and I'm always blaming situation. What is this kind of a story? This kind of a story is a story of a victim. This is not a leadership story again. So nobody is going to listen to a story of a victim and nobody is going to listen to a story of a superwoman or a superman. So victim story, after a while, somebody will tell you, go have this cup of tea and then go and meet a counselor or, you know, a psychotherapist. So I'll give you a psychotherapist's number. You go and meet her. Yeah, so nobody wants to listen to everybody is not an agony aunt here. So how will you build a story? So if I have to tell my story and end my story where I say, then I became a bankrupt, you know. You're trying to tell people that, see, you become a bankrupt. And that's how you're coming to my circle. So you have to pick up a story where you picked up lessons of your life. Yeah, so that's a leadership story. I have a short favorite anecdote story of mine. So the story is about Mullah Nasruddin. Mullah Nasruddin was a trader. And so once when he was, becoming a trader, he got a pumpkin rind and he cut the pumpkin rind into some 20 pieces and he made a chain himself. And every time he did his business, he would like his pumpkin necklace and do the business. So while he was trading dry fruits, shawls, and slowly he became very popular and everybody started saying, oh, you know that Mullah Nasruddin, oh, you know that man with the pumpkin necklace, I got this chapels from him, I got this dupatta from him. So Mullah Nasruddin was very happy because he was becoming popular as a man with the pumpkin necklace. So he would always hold his pumpkin necklace and go to sleep. One morning he woke up and he saw a madman wearing pumpkin necklace. And that madman was saying, I'm the man with the pumpkin necklace. I'm the man with the pumpkin necklace. So Mullah said, no, I'm the man with the pumpkin necklace. Madman said, I'm the man with the pumpkin necklace. Don't you see this? So this Mullah Nasruddin thought to himself, he is the man with the pumpkin necklace. Then who am I? Yeah. So if Gitanjali Kaur is the founder of Secret Passages and she is gone through her own life work, self work, and she's founded this company, tomorrow anybody will stand up and say that I'm Gitanjali Kaur and, I'm the founder of Secret Passages. Does that person become founder of Secret Passages, Gitanjali Kaur? No. Yeah, so who am I is my unique story journey. So we need to sit down and write. Like, even Bhagavad Gita talks about dharma. Each one of us have our own seed that we need to grow and we need to bear fruits of. Yeah, so a mango tree will give birth to mangoes. A mango seed will give birth to mangoes. Guava will give birth to guava. So we need to find out, what is that your unique qualities? Okay. After that, we need to write down, what are your weaknesses? What are your fears? And once you write down your fears, you need to then find out, how do you make your fears into your strength? When did you make your fears into your strength? And that's the story that you will tell. And that's how you will keep working on your journey and keep finding, how have you grown with time? And then we also have stories of influences. Many a times we get influenced by others, right? And they are helping us to become the stories of our lives, the people that we are becoming, the version that I'm becoming, you know, from 20 years ago or 30 years ago to what I've become now. So, there's a very famous story of Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs, when he was young, he saw his father painting the fence. And his father was painting the back of the fence. So Steve Jobs asks his father, "Why are you painting the back of the fence? Nobody's going to see her." So Steve Jobs' father looked at Steve Jobs and said, "A good craftsman, when he's making a wooden cabinet, he will use the same wood at the back of the cabinet, which he will use at the front of the cabinet." And this inspiration is what Steve Jobs lived on. And he got his passion for perfection here. So in my personal life, many a times I've been influenced by my grandparents. I've been influenced by my mother, by my father, by some people who came in my life, by my mentors, by my coaches, right? They have shaped me. So you need to find out who are these influences who have come in your life and then work on those stories as well. So that's where you find your influential stories, you find your own who am I stories, and then you have to now build a story to influence others. Influencing others is a very strong leadership story that you're building, right? Because that's a success story of your life. How are you going to influence others? That's a leadership story, right? That's the story how you get followers. So what's your leadership story and how will you work on your leadership story? Is the work that you will do. So a good leader often shares his vision, often shares a dream with the public, often tells the other one that you have the rights to dream through the stories. So I have a very beautiful poem here. This is actually a speech told by Martin Luther King Jr. in 1963 on August 28th. And the speech is called, "I Have a Dream." I'm not unmindful that some of you have come here out of great trials and tribulations. Some of you have come fresh from narrow cells. Some of you have come from areas where your quest for freedom left you battered by the storms of persecution and staggered by the winds of police brutality. You have been the veterans of creative suffering. Continue to work with the faith that unearned suffering is redemptive. Go back to Mississippi, go back to Alabama, go back to Georgia, go back to the slums of our northern cities, knowing that somehow this situation can and will be changed. What has the impact been made? Let us not wallow in the valley of despair. I say to you today, my friends, that in spite of the difficulties and frustrations of the moment, I still have a dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a desert state sweltering with the heat of injustice and oppression, will rise, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of God shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see together. This is our hope. This is the faith with which I've returned to the South. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. This is a speech Martin Luther gave. Yeah, so a good leader builds up a good story, which is completely self-led, talks about when did he or she crack open and discover the meaning of life, discover gold and treasure. and then shares their vision with others. Yeah, Apurva? So that's fine. We're going to talk today on art of leading self through stories.
Thank you, ma'am.
We have questions.
Ma'am, we have questions from the audience.
Yes.
Ma'am, can I ask?
We have questions, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I can't read the questions. Will you be telling?
Yes, ma'am, sure. Ma'am, our first question is, how stories can build character of an individual?
Yes. So, yes, stories are talking about your values and your culture and, you know, the times that you have taken that decision and that step, which is different than what otherwise anyone could take, the road less traveled. That's how your character starts coming in. So, for example, you know, you are in a room where you could get 10,000 rupees, you know, just by doing nothing. And, you know, somebody says, okay, you keep this 10,000 rupees and it's just a gift for you. And you say, I haven't done anything. Why should I take 10,000 rupees? That talks about your character, right? It just talks about your integrity. You could have taken that 10,000 rupees, gone and partied with your friends and come back. But you don't deserve that 10,000 rupees. So you question, why do I have to take this 10,000 rupees? So these are the stories that you're talking about yourself. That I said no. I learned to say no. Yeah. So when you go through difficult times and you work on, you know, that turning point of your life, which builds your character, which helps you to go inside and, you know, find the answers, and then you come out as the story that helps you to build your character. So, yeah, as I also mentioned, that your stories are the ones which are very authentic. It's not somebody else's story. It's your unique journey, right? So it automatically talks about your character, talks about your upbringing, talks about the values that your family has given you, right? It brings in all that seed when you are sharing your story. And also, when you become authentic, you end up opening up. You become transparent. Okay, this is what I am. For example, today you see that I'm thin, but, you know, some time ago, maybe I was really fat. And when I was fat, everybody made fun of my weight, made fun of, you know, the clothes that I was wearing. People would say, oh, what a big belly you have. So when I talk about all this, I connect to you faster. And then I tell you, how did I lose weight? One day I decided I have to lose weight. And then I worked on losing weight. Or somebody who's gone to a vernacular medium school has gone to a Gujarati medium school and could not make friends very easily. Because, you know, in the circle, everybody's talking in English. And how, you know, she still studied her grammar and she still made little efforts to speak in English. And today she is a high-level writer and a speaker. No one will believe that she was in a Gujarati medium school, but she has to tell the story. Yeah, so that's where, you know, the telling of the stories happen. You have a second question I can read, Apurva. It says stories come from the soil of a place. What does it mean? It means the stories, I think you mentioned, it's about the culture, it's about your upbringing, it's about how you come with the stories. And as I mentioned, sit down and, you know, look back at your life stories, close your eyes and look at where were you when you were 6 years old? Who was next to me? Who was taking care of me at that point of time? Which house was I in? Which was that land? What kind of stories did my mother tell me? What kind of stories did my grandparents tell me? What kind of food did I eat at that point? So the more you work with your, you know, past stories or stories of your childhood, because we are a product of our childhood. The more you work, the more, you know, you bring your culture, your upbringing, and that's what you also pass on to the coming generation. So that's where stories come from, the soil of a place.
No, 10 minutes, yeah.
Yeah, so it's always have the courage to speak the truth and become more open and more transparent. The more open and the more transparent you become, the more people start believing in you. And the more people start believing in you, the more trust you're building around you, right? And that's a mark of a good leader. So you lead self and you lead others.
Yeah, so if you all, I can give you a simple idea about starting to, you know, working on yourself from today onwards is every once in a month, find a special space to sit, a corner where nobody is going to come and disturb you, not even your kitten, not even your puppy, you know, not even your phone, okay, nor your girlfriend, nor your boyfriend, nor your neighbor. Nobody is going to come and disturb you. Okay, and light a little candle and say a little prayer and take your sketch pen, your crayons, pick up any color, pick up any sketch pen color and go back to the roots of your life. Start working from 0 to 4. Okay, see where you are in your life when you are 0 to 4. Who are the people who are around you? Who took care of you? What is the memory? As I said, images. Your brain is wired with images. You are always getting pictures. So close your eyes and think, which is that picture? Then draw that picture. Yeah? Then go 4 to 8, 8 to 10. So then you will notice that every fifth year, you have had a conscious moment shift happening in your life, a change happening in your life. Yeah? So it has been told that every fifth year, a shift takes place. Okay, so you have to find out which is that fifth year and what happened and what was the shift that happened. Then you will see that who was your first friend in school. Write that down. Or which was the best birthday party you had. Write that down. Yeah. Then write down what was the first class you all ever wanted to take up? Was it a dance class? Was it a singing class? Was it an embroidery class? What is the first accomplishment did you have? Was it a finishing of some beautiful embroidery work? Was it a finishing of a painting? You know, what was the first time when you said a story about your life and someone said, wow, did you do that? I don't believe it. Did you go on a trek? Did you reach that mountaintop all alone by yourself? Write that down. This one told me this on this date. Yeah, so find your teenage stories when you were 14, 15, 16, 17. Find out when you were a rebel. What were your weaknesses? What was your fears? What did you feel? What if you feel in the exam? Was that a fear? Okay, what were your biggest anxieties? Write that down. Because all these are your stories. Okay? And then see what are your aspirations, what are your dreams, you know, on the branches. And then make little fruits and find out what is that you can gift everyone. Because that from that fruit is the seed that will grow another tree there. Yeah, so on the fruits, write down, what have you learned? Patience, tolerance, right? And where did they come from? Your own reservoir. Everything is inside you. Yeah, so your fruits are something that you have got from these lived experiences. Yeah, so that's my little exercise, which, you know, you can sit down and you can do and create a utopia world where you would love to live in. Yeah, anything else, Apurva, do we have any questions? No, ma'am, thank you so much.
Okay. Anything that you personally think or need to work on, you think that your leadership stories need?
Ma'am, aapki exercise zaroor karenge.
Kaun sa exercise acha laga aapko?
Ma'am, jo ek corner mein jaake baithna and khud ke bare mein hi sochna, that's a perfect exercise. Kya aap khud ko jaan sakte ho?
Aapko apne best 2-3 friends ko aapke ghar pe fir invite karna hai, aur fir aapko unko apni puri tree dikhani hai.
Yes ma'am.
और फिर उनको आपको ये कहानी बतानी है. सो यू क्रिएट अ नॉन जजमेंटल सेफ स्पेस. फिर आप आपके फ्रेंड को बोलना नेक्स्ट संडे को आप आओ और आपका ट्री बना के हमारे साथ शेयर करें. सो यू कैन इवन डू इट विद द फैमिली. So you can tell your mom and dad and your grandparents, everyone, to make a tree. And one by one, you can give everyone a spotlight to share their stories. Yeah?
Yes.
Thank you so much, Apoorvang.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. On behalf of Orange City Literature Fest, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Bye.
Take care, ma'am. Have a nice day.
Have a nice day.
20 years of existence. 2 universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.